Assalamu alaikum. So in this lecture, what we will do is talk about how we can use recombinant DNA technology, that is how we can use a recombinant DNA molecule to analyze DNA regulatory sequences and to determine if two proteins interact with each other or not. So we'll start with analysis of transcriptional regulatory sequences. And we'll talk about the role of enzymes, specifically an enzyme known as luciferase. So, basic introduction. So here we have a eukaryotic gene composed of exons and introns. There is a transcription start site right here. And this gene is under the control of a number of regulatory sequences. So you have the core promoter. That is, it's composed of the tetra box, the -35 region, and so on. And we have also the promoter proximal element as well. Okay, and we might also have an enhancer. Okay, we can also have a suppressor or a silencer as well. So we can have activating regulatory sequences, or we can have inhibitory regulatory sequences. So we are concerned with these regions right here. That's what we want to study. We don't want to study the gene itself, rather we want to study what regulatory sequences does a specific gene have. So we take advantage of an enzyme known as luciferase. Now, luciferase was first isolated from firefly, and it has nothing to do with firefly burger, okay? So here you have a firefly, right? And there's light coming out of its, you know, behind. So it fluoresces. Now, scientists were able to determine how fireflies fluoresce. And it turns out that there is a molecule known as luciferin, and this luciferin is converted into a product known as oxyluciferin by an enzyme known as luciferase. And luciferase is a monooxygenase, so it is an oxidoreductase, because it takes one atom of oxygen, it puts it on a molecule, and it puts the other oxygen atom on another molecule. In this case, it is CO2. Regardless, so the idea here is that you have this reaction catalyzed by luciferase, and this product is not really that important. What's important is that light comes out. So scientists were able to take advantage of this enzyme. And the idea here with the luciferase assay, and assay means like an experiment or steps that we use to experiment something or to measure something. So the idea here is that we want to analyze the activity of a specific gene. Okay, we want to study the regulatory sequences. We don't care much about the gene itself, rather we care about the promoter region or the regulatory sequences. So what we do is that we make an expression vector. Again, we engineer an expression vector, and we insert the luciferase gene inside it. Except that this gene would be under the control of a promoter region of another gene that we want to analyze. Okay, so really this gene and the transcription factors that bind to the promoter region really do not care what the gene that they are transcribing. All they care about is that they bind to a promoter and they start transcription. Okay, so this is the expression vector, and we insert it into a cell. Okay, now this cell would have the plasmid inside it. And by the way, again, this can be a human cell. It doesn't have to be a bacterial cell. Cells don't care. All they care about is that there is something that looks like a DNA that regulatory proteins can bind to elements. Okay, so we insert the plasmid inside, and we want to determine if the if a specific gene is active or not. Okay, again, we don't care much about the gene; we care about the regulatory sequences themselves. So we want to know if these regulatory sequences are under positive regulation, that is, you have transcription going on, or under negative regulation. So we insert the plasmid inside, and if the gene, or you know, if the regulatory sequences are under positive regulation, you should have production of the luciferase protein or enzyme. And when we add luciferin to our sample, if there is a lot of luciferase, it means that there would be a signal, and that tells me that the promoter region is under positive regulation. If a promoter region is under negative negative regulation, there would be no luciferase, and as a result, there would be no light. Now, not only that, we can tell if it is on or off. We can also tell if it is really, really active or slightly active by the amount of light that is produced in our sample. Now, here's an example of a typical experiment that is usually done in laboratories. So we have a promoter region of any particular gene of interest. We take this region right here. Now, if you analyze it, we notice that there is the core promoter region right here. This is where the DNA polymerase binds to. We have an activating region. Let's say we have a promoter proximal element, or we have a positive regulatory sequence. And we have a silencer right here, okay? So we have a repressor region. Now, we don't know much about this promoter region. We want to know what the different parts of the promoter region do exactly. So what we do is that we construct a plasmid, an expression vector containing luciferase that is under the regulation of this promoter. Now, what we do then is that we also produce a promoter regions that contain deletions, different deletions, and we want to tell what would happen if we delete this region right here in terms of the activity of the luciferase. What would happen if we delete this region? What would happen if we delete this region? And so on. Okay, and that would give me an indication of the importance of this region in terms of positive or negative regulation of gene expression. So what we do here is that we transfect cells, that is, we insert the plasmid or DNA. So we transfect cells with the plasmid without any promoter, okay? So there should be no production of luciferase. But in fact, there is some production of luciferase. There is some background because it's like a faucet that is really not tightly closed. Okay, so there should be some leakage. We talked about leakage in the molecular biology course last year. So there's very little production of luciferase. There's almost 0% luciferase activity. And we can transfect cells with a plasmid containing luciferase, but it's under the regulation of a good promoter, regardless of what the promoter is. It's just something that tells me that the experiment is working fine. So here we have a negative control, meaning that there is no production of luciferase. And here we have a positive control. It tells me that the experiment is working. and you can see that the luciferase activity is maximal, it's 100%. So what we do then is that we transfect cells with the expression vector containing luciferase, except that it is under the control of the promoter of interest, that is this promoter right here, the whole thing. So we insert the whole thing. And notice that luciferase activity is almost 60% of control, okay? So because this is a really good promoter, okay? So there is luciferase activity. Good. Then what we do is that we start to chop off the promoter region. So we start to delete different regions of the promoter, and we want to see the activity of the luciferase, which tells me about the activity of the promoter itself, or the different regions of the promoter. So what we do is that we delete this region right here. Okay, so right here, this region is deleted. There is little change in the production of the luciferase activity. Okay, so we remove this region and maybe part of the repressor region. There is a little increase, but not a whole much. Okay, so we increase the deleted region. We chop off more of the repressor region. Notice that the increase in the activity of the luciferase activity. Now this increase right here tells me that what I'm removing is actually a repressor region. Okay, so you remove more of the repressor region. Again, this change, by the way, is really minimal. It's nothing. So again, we remove the whole repressor region, and there is production of luciferase that is maximal compared to the whole promoter that is under study. Okay, now what we do next is that we remove more of the promoter region. So we chop off more of the DNA, and we remove part of the activating region. Notice the dramatic reduction in the expression of the luciferase, which is reflected by the percentage of luciferase activity. So there is reduction in the luciferase activity because there is little production of luciferase. So I know what I'm removing right here is actually an activating region. Okay, so we remove more of this activating region and part of the core promoter, let's say. So there is also reduction. It's almost like very similar to as if there is no promoter whatsoever. Okay, so you remove more and more, and there is little production of luciferase. So what this experiment tells me is that first, I have the whole promoter region. If I remove part of the promoter region, there is an increase in the activity of luciferase in my sample, meaning that what I'm doing here is that I'm removing a repressor region, a silencer maybe. And if I remove part of more of the promoter region, what I'm doing here is that I'm removing an activating region because of this decrease. Now, if I remove the core promoter, and I know that this is a core promoter, but I don't know that this region contains an activating region or a repressor region. So if I remove the core promoter, there is almost no production of luciferase. So this experiment tells me if the promoter region contains a repressor region or an activating region. And this is the luciferase assay. Okay, so we can use recombinant DNA technology as well to determine if two proteins interact with each other. Now, in terms of determining protein-protein interaction, there are two things that we can do. Actually, there are more, but I'll focus on two experiments. The first is something we call immunoprecipitation, and the other one is yeast-to-hybrid system. Now, the idea is that proteins can interact with many other proteins. And you can have a large protein having two domains, and this domain, for example, the domain to the left can interact with two different proteins, and the right domain can interact with different proteins as well. And even these proteins can also interact with each other, by the way. So we want to determine if a protein can interact with another protein. Okay? So with immunoprecipitation, what we do is that we remove all proteins from cells. So we have a bunch of cells and we open up these cells. Now these cells would have proteins interacting with each other, and we preserve the protein-protein interaction. Okay, so we take all of these proteins, and what we do is that we use antibodies that are specific to a certain protein, which is the pinky one right here. So we can pull down this protein and all of the other proteins that are interacting with it. And all of the other proteins can be removed. Okay, so all non-bound proteins, non-interacting proteins would be removed, and we keep our protein of interest as well as all of the other interacting proteins. And then we can analyze our sample. We can analyze all of these proteins by Western blot, for example, or SDS page, or any other technique. Okay, so this is known as co-immunoprecipitation, because what we do is that we precipitate, we pull down, we precipitate a protein using antibodies. Immuno means that we're using antibodies. Okay, co, because we are not only precipitating a single protein, rather we are precipitating all of the other binding proteins. So there is co-precipitation. Now, this is one example, one technique. Now, there's the other technique is known as yeast to hybrid system. But in order first, in order to do yeast to hybrid system, we have to create a DNA library. So what is a DNA library? Well, a DNA library is basically a collection of DNA fragments that are cloned inside plasmids, for example. Okay, so we have recombinant DNA molecules. So it's almost like a book library. So you're interested in a certain book. So you go to the library and you go to the second floor, aisle number 5, and you go to shelf number, I don't know, 3, and you pick out a certain book. So similarly with the DNA library, if we're interested in a certain DNA fragment, and this DNA fragment is inside a plasmid, and this plasmid is in a vial or a tube, and this tube is in a freezer, in the second shelf of a freezer, and it is actually in box number 11. So all we have to do really is we go to that freezer, second shelf, box number 11, we take out the box, and inside this box we have many, many tubes. In a certain location, we have the sample that contains the plasmid that has our DNA fragment of interest. So that is basically a DNA library. Now, there are two types of DNA libraries. One of them is known as genomic DNA library, and the other is known as a cDNA library. Now, with the genomic DNA library, we have the whole genome of a cell, okay, like human genome or bacterial genome, whatever. We take this DNA and we cut it into smaller fragments using restriction endonucleases. And we place each one of these fragments inside, we place each one of these DNA fragments inside plasmids. Okay, so we have recombinant DNA. And we transfect, we insert one DNA one vector, one recombinant DNA, one plasmid inside bacterial cells, and each one of them would grow carrying the plasmid inside them, and we can freeze these bacterial cells. So each vial would contain a clone of bacterial cells, and each one of them contains the same exact plasmid. Okay, so again, whenever I'm interested in a certain fragment, you know, I go to the freezer and I pull out the bacteria that contains the plasmid of interest. Now, here in this case, we have everything in a genome right here. Now, with a cDNA library, no, it's more selective. So what we do first is that we take the messenger RNA, the whole, all messenger RNA molecules in a cell, we convert them to cDNA, complementary DNA, by reverse transcriptase. Now, remember that if we take human messenger RNA molecules and convert them to cDNAs, now these cDNAs do not contain introns, right? Because they're all spliced out. So we have the cDNA molecules just containing exons. And we place each one of these cDNA molecules in a plasmid. We clone them into plasmids. And we transfect these plasmids inside bacterial cells. Now, bacterial cells contain, each one of them contains a plasmid which contains a specific gene, right? Now, so the difference between the two here is that with the genomic DNA library, we have everything inside a genome. So we have the exons, introns, promoter regions, enhancers, telomeres, you name it, everything in a genome. Whereas if we start with messenger RNA and we create cDNA library, we have DNA fragments that represent active genes, that's one, without introns, just exons. So if I can create the same exact identical genomic DNA library, if I take DNA from, I don't know, like stomach cells, epithelial cells, and so on. But if I create a cDNA library, now the source makes a difference because here we're talking about the active genes, okay? So if I create a cDNA library from stomach cells, for example, it would be different than the cDNA library that I would create from skin cells because they express different genes, right? So if I create genomic DNA library from stomach cells or skin cells, they would be identical because they have the same exact genome, but cDNA library is a different story. So again, another slide illustrating the difference between genomic DNA library and cDNA library. Okay, so here we have everything in DNA. And here we only have the active genes, okay? Now, so what is the yeast-to hybrid system? So the yeast-to hybrid system is a technique that we take advantage of yeast, okay? In order to determine if two proteins interact with each other or not. So how do you do that? See, in yeast, there is a genetic system known as the UAS system, okay? There is a region right here, the UAS region, upstream activating sequence. And this region here lies upstream of a reporter gene, okay? Like the galactosidase. Okay, so luciferase, by the way, is known also as a reporter gene because it reports something, it tells me something. So here, in this case, in yeast, we have the galactosidase gene under the control of the UAS system. Okay, galactosidase, by the way, is the enzyme that cleaves lactate. Okay, I'm sorry, lactose, the sugar lactose. Okay, So the UAS system is under the control of a transcriptional factor. And this transcriptional factor is composed of a DNA binding domain known as the Gal4-Bd binding domain and an activation domain which activates transcription. Okay? So in order to activate transcription of the LACZ, the reporter gene, we have to have these two domains next to each other, very close to each other, or part of each other. Okay? The DNA binding domain and the Gal4 activation domain. And we can introduce these two proteins, this protein containing both domains inside a plasmid. And we transfect this plasmid inside yeast cells. Remember when we talked about making recombinant proteins composed of different domains? So here you have gene A, and it's composed of two domains, and gene B composed of two domains. We can create a recombinant gene containing domain from one protein or gene and a different domain from a different gene. So we take advantage of domains. So here's what we do. We create the Gal4 protein that contains separate domains. So you have the DNA binding domain separated from the activation domain. And we create the DNA binding domain to be produced with a certain protein, okay, a target protein. That, and we know what this target protein is. And we create the activation domain generated linked with a domain or another protein. Okay? Now, if these two proteins interact with each other, okay, these two domains, the activation domain and the DNA binding domain, would be close to each other and there would be transcription going on. If these two proteins do not interact with each other, it means that these two domains would be far away from each other and there would be no transcription. And as a result, there is no signal coming out from this cell. So, what signal are we talking about here? So, again, we have a yeast cell and we transfect a yeast cell with two plasmids. One of them contains the DNA binding domain that becomes part of protein X, and I know what protein X is. And we have another plasmid that contains the activation domain with gene Y. So this activation domain would be part of protein Y. Now, I don't know what protein Y is, okay? So I can have a library of this plasmid, a library of Ys, okay? So I can have Y1, Y2, Y3, Y4. We can have different Y genes associated or part of this expression vector. So we transfect these two plasmids into yeast cells. So we'll have production of X and production of a different Y. Now, if this Y1 interacts with protein X, it means that these two, domains, the binding DNA binding domain and the activation domain, would be close to each other and there would be transcription. Okay, so how do I know that there is transcription? Well, what we do is that we use a special molecule, a lactose analog known as XGAL. Okay, so this is what XGAL is. It looks like a lactose, except that when it is cleaved by galactosidase, it produces a molecule that turns blue. So if a yeast cell has an active galactosidase, it means that it will be able to metabolize X-gal, and the yeast cell would turn blue. Okay? If there is no production of the galactosidase, it means that there would be no metabolism of X-gal, and the yeast cell would look white. Okay? So this is the reporter gene. Okay, and we use a special molecule right here. Now, so these are the possibilities. If I transfect my cells, yeast cells, with a plasmid that contains the whole Gal4 system, the Gal4 protein, the DNA binding domain and the activation domain, of course there would be transcription of the LacZ gene. There is galactosidase, it can metabolize X-gal, and cells turn blue. Let's say that we have the DNA binding domain associated with protein X, but there is no interaction with the other protein, meaning that the DNA binding domain would not be close to the activation domain, and there would be no production of the gene. So colonies would look white. Let's say that I have a plasmid that has just the activation domain without the DNA binding domain. Again, there would be no transcription whatsoever, and colonies or cells would look white. Now, let's say that we have two proteins that interact with each other, okay? And this protein is associated with the DNA binding domain, and the other protein is associated with the activation domain. If there is interaction between these two, it means that these two become very close to each other, and there would be transcription and colonies or cells turn blue. So that tells me that X and Y do interact with each other. Okay? Remember that here I'm transfecting each one of them I'm preparing an expression vector for each one of them separately on different plasmids. Okay, so what do we do then? So you look at this plate right here. So we have every one of these colonies, the blue colonies, we know that there is interaction between X and Y. Okay, and each colony contains a different Y than the other one, but they all contain the same X. Okay, because I want to know protein X interacts with what Y protein. So here we have Y1, Y2, Y3, Y4, and so on. So I'm not interested in the white colonies, because white colonies mean that there is no interaction between X and whatever Y is inside these cells. I'm interested in the blue colonies that contain protein X and protein Y, and this Y protein can interact with X. So there's transcription of galactosidase, there's metabolism of X-gal, and the colony looks blue. So what I do then is that we take this colony, okay, we isolate the plasmid inside them, and we can determine which Y gene is inside the plasmids inside these yeast cells, okay, by sequencing, by whatever technique, and we'll talk about these techniques later on. So that's how we can determine the proteins that interact with protein X.